All right. It is 6:04. This is the December 1st Raleigh Water Board meeting. This meeting is being videotaped for everyone's knowledge, and we're ready to open the meeting. Okay. So we've called the meeting to order. So the first thing on is citizens' query, and I'll open it to the floor.
Mr. Chairman, I have to leave at 7:15.
7:15? Okay. To leave, duly noted. So joining us there, give him a chance to, from a citizens' query standpoint, if anybody has questions. Going.
Okay. I'm gonna bring up the issue I brought up last meeting. I stated to the board, and we voted as a board, to bring up the issue of getting an executive session regarding some confidential issues here regarding litigation, and it affects the board, and we need to have an executive session to advise this board on how to proceed. And so I'm going to put a motion forward that we, number one, get legal counsel regarding this matter, and number two, schedule a executive session meeting regarding the litigation. And it needs to happen before December 7th. There's a deadline on that. And also there's some other issues that have come to my attention regarding some potential criminal stuff. So we need to talk about this in executive session.
Okay, I'll take it from the top. I checked with the town's administrator, Debbie Egan, who is in charge of all litigation with the town, and she told me, point blank, there is no litigation against the water board, so I did not put an executive session on here because there is no legal case pending or otherwise against the water board. Legal counsel, Judith Pickett provided that letter. It's been provided in the past and as well earlier this year, back in August and September, that the board is not entitled to legal counsel except through the auspices of the selectman's office. Again, the litigation, there is none that I have been made aware of as the chairman, and therefore I will not move to executive session. So
you were made aware of it at the last meeting. We talked about the need to go into it. We put it off to this meeting to discuss it. Unfortunately, we can't talk about these issues in open session. We need to talk about them in an executive session. The town administrator is wrong. There are two members of this board that are being under a lawsuit about to happen. So we need to have that addressed in an executive session. And I'm going to make a motion that we proceed for an executive session before the 7th with a legal counsel that's dedicated to this board, specialized legal counsel.
Again, I will make this statement that, one, you're not entitled to the legal counsel, and two, I can't back that because there is no litigation against this board. If it is, again, I'm not going to make another statement.
So what would the, not under the previous executive session that was illegal, so what of the nine criteria are you going into executive session on? That's going to be my question, right? We're back to square one. So what are the nine of the nine criteria is it executive session? I don't have my notes here from, I came here right from work.
So well, litigation, that's it, litigation.
I don't think that's.
So it's if it's against you, again, I'm not having a discussion. So I made the statement.
Well, you can have a discussion, there is no, because it's an executive session subject.
Nope, only so if you, there you is can, no litigation pending
so I,
against
I
the
put
board.
A motion, do we need to? We need to do an executive session with a legal counsel.
Trouble. This is trouble again.
So, I will not entertain that, but Stu, you can, you know, what's your position?
Trouble.
Unfortunately, it's not on the agenda, Tim.
It's not on the agenda, Stu, because he didn't put it on it like he was supposed to, because we voted on it at the last meeting.
And the chairman has the ultimate decisions on what goes on the agenda.
No, it
and
doesn't.
Tim, you're aware of
the board
that.
Has the ultimate decision on what goes on the agenda. That's
gonna,
what the
not going to debate
is.
It.
So the board voted last time to have it on the agenda. So we have every legal right to vote, second a motion to go in a legal executive session regarding litigation against two members of this board.
Mr. Chairman?
He did not have a...
Yeah, move on to the next item.
Well, give Stu a chance to talk.
I think that it's something that the town's already asked for somebody to step down, and if for whatever reason they don't want to. And I think he's trying to make the rest of you miserable. And I think that you need to take over.
I appreciate that, editorials aside. You know, I'm trying to keep this, you know, civil and right on top. But Stu, and I don't know what you...
I made a motion, Mr. Chairman, and he either seconds it or not. And if he doesn't second it, then it goes dead. So it'll be brought up at the end of the meeting or whatever as an agenda item for the next meeting.
And I will not entertain it unless there is litigation pending.
It's the board thing.
Stu, this is the last of it. Stu, do you have anything to say?
Well, I have.
So, hold on, guys.
I think we need a legal opinion.
As a board?
As a board.
So you are you're free to second his agenda, but again, I will not support it, and it will not go on the agenda. So there is no litigation against the water board. You may have litigation pending against yourselves as a public official, but I would recommend you talk to Deb Egan. So
we are board members.
I recommend that you talk to Deb Egan. Stu, do you want a second on that?
It's from a water department employee against two board members. Why would it be a personal thing?
I don't know, but it's not naming the water board, so that's all I know for the facts.
I just want to be a reminder that a month ago, Mr. Dalzell, you made a motion to change the chairman to Mr. Manning. So there was a trust there that was the shift, per se. So I'm just asking you to think about it long and hard about what's going on here. And I've asked again, I have the 9 reasons for executive session and it's not on there. So I'm trying to help you also, Mr. Dalzell, not to be led any further.
Well, the lawyer would, you know, make sure the wording was correct in order to go into executive session.
Additionally, we can't have a vote during citizens' query.
Okay.
So that's a moot point
so
as well.
So it doesn't make sense to even have the board vote on what goes on the agenda, because you and the town administrator brought it off the agenda for this meeting. So why would you do that?
Why? Because I am ultimately responsible for the agenda.
Well, it could be discussion with this board.
The discussion is over, and we're going to move on.
This board has the authority.
Any other citizens' queries?
This board has the authority. Under chapter...
Old business. Update from Mr. Tooney on the missing attachments from 1020, 1006, 929, 918, and 911. Do you have a status on the missing attachments thing?
I can't find them. I think that we ought to have the staff go through the tapes and recreate the statements that were made for the attachments.
Okay. Fiscal 17 capital budget discussion under old business. We all have a handout. If you can pull that out, we can discuss.
So is there a resolution of the missing attachments?
No, moving forward right now. Do you have your document for discussion?
Yes, I do.
So I'll read these into the record so everyone knows what we're talking about. The capital expenses for fiscal year 17 that we want to discuss is paving 401 Central Street, $60,000. The parking area is unsafe and crumbling, ice issues in the winter and flooding. People have been tripping and falling out in the parking lot, to transfer funds from the stabilization to an article. The second item is Prospect Hill exterior tank repair, $100,000. Carried over from fiscal year 16, did not have enough approved to complete in fiscal year 16 recommended. Transfer funds from the stabilization to operating. Paving Pingree Farm Road, $160,000. cutting trees, permitting, paving. There's some cleanup that'll have to be done along the side. It's unsafe for fire and rescue, and specifically for chemical deliveries, the road is narrow, too narrow to transfer. It's too narrow, and we want to transfer funds from the stabilization to an article. The dehumidification issues, we may not have all that information in time, but that's $400,000 as a placeholder. Retrofit the dehumidification system to the water treatment plant, transfer from the stabilization fund to an article, and purchase an F-550 dump truck for an amount of $70,000. Trade in the F-850 and the F-450 to purchase an F-550, which is right-sized. Dump recommended carrying in the operating budget under capital for a total of $790,000. So the $70,000 in the operating budget has already been carrying $90,000 in a previous budget and will not increase the rates. This decreased the capital request by $20,000. And the $720,000 transfer from stabilization to the articles for capital projects, this will not raise the rates. Okay, that's critical for people to hear. Stabilization should be used for the system improvements and the upgrades. So, do we need to make motions at this point, or is it just for our discussion and then get ready for the article, get the articles prepared from a procedural standpoint?
Well, I'd like to hear back from the board. I mean, this is the capital plan that I prepared for the next fiscal budget year, and you know, this is the time for the board to have discussions about the budget, so.
Okay. So let's take it from the top, okay? And Bob will get to you, okay. Gentlemen. So the parking area, we'd had money for paving, that went high. I think it would be behoovous to repair this before we have someone really get more seriously hurt. I know I twisted my ankle the other night, about a month ago, on a chunk of tar out there. Everybody that comes in here can see. The side of the building is starting to get compromised. Stu, you do a lot of construction. You know, what do you think about this parking lot?
Mr. Chairman, August the 14th, Ms. Wise's third day on the job. Actually, it was the second day, because she wasn't here the second day. Third day on the job, we had already put out to bid to do the circular driveway in the front by $9,500. The pavers showed up one morning early, and Miss Weiser sent him on their way. The next thing that we know, it's a $60,000 job to get. If you did the circular driveway and went down each side and you tripled it, you're still at $30,000 and under. I don't understand how it mushroomed to $60,000.
I wasn't here for that, but RFP that went out, Mary Beth?
So when I first came on board, knowing the history and the issues with purchasing and budgeting and misappropriation of funds, I was not going to sign off on a job that I had nothing to do with. I could not find out the backup and support documentation to show any proof that anybody did any homework on anything or solicited prices for almost a $10,000 project. That's why I stopped the project, because I was ultimately going to have to sign off on all of that stuff, and I'm responsible for the budget.
That's not accurate.
I called the chairman.
Three members here, and the chairman had three bids. $9,500 to do the circular driveway in the front.
Okay.
There was nothing in the office, no file. It said paving 401 Central Street. There was no bid sheet. There was nothing. We looked.
Okay.
Which we need, so but you said you called the chairman?
I called the chairman at the time when the pavement, and nobody told me they were going to pave to begin with. I hear all this ruckus outside.
Chairman, Roy?
Yes.
Roy.
And I went outside.
He had the quotes.
Okay.
And then I said, whoa, nobody told me about this.
Okay.
And that's when I called the chairman.
Well, they couldn't tell you about it. You were not here on the second day of your job.
I was here at the water board meeting the night before.
So, history aside, the quote that went, the RFP that went out, the bid spec that went out was for the entire place, and I think that addresses some of the issues that were brought up by the, not the Board of Health, the
Conservation,
thank you.
Yes.
The Conservation Commission.
Yes.
So
it
that
was for grading out back as well.
And that addresses brings relief to that issue or whatever they brought up. So that sounds like that's what drove it as well.
The water department has a backhoe, two dump trucks. They could grade up out there themselves.
I have one distribution guy.
I'd like to say something. It doesn't make sense.
You had a backhoe operator at the time.
A $9,500 project goes to 60 grand. It just doesn't make sense.
Of course it can.
If she doesn't have any documentation.
It has to do with what's going to do underneath, the material. Oh. Are they going to dig it down 2 feet? They're going to dig it 6 inches? Or they just go over the top?
If you double the job, it's going to be 20,000. It's a different area. It's like these contractors, I believe, they price it out by square foot.
Okay.
There but, you know, the square foot, they're square foot.
I'm going to push this off.
You can put it for 4 inches?
Well, I make a motion that we
can do whatever you want.
I would be happy if it was 25,000, no more than 25,000. And if we put that figure out there for the paving job, guess what? It'll come in under 25,000. But if you put it out at 100,000, it's going to come in at 95,000. So that's what happens when you put out numbers that people look at and they say, okay, well, there's some money there. So that's what happened here. It was a $10,000 project and somebody put it out for 60 and it came in at 58.5. Why? Because somebody put it out for 60. That's the kind of stuff that we have to be careful of.
Well,
I just wanted to know if the original purchase orders were found from the prior chairman. Where are those? Were they ever found?
No.
Oh, so we never knew what was spec'd for that purchase order.
The previous chairman had them.
Right, so that's what I'm saying though. Comparatively, I don't know if it's just a top coat or whatever. I don't know what it was. It was the superintendent.
It was the bid spec that was written for the paving for this parking lot was written to the standard specifications of the town paving. I worked with the highway surveyor to get the depth, you know, milling, repurposing, whatever the technical terms are for paving. But it was not an overlay. It was not to just come in and overlay. This parking lot, that would be $10,000 to overlay this parking lot would be a waste of money.
Right.
Because it's if you look, the entire parking lot, even the front, all you have to do is just go out there and the pavement just will come up in your hand.
If I remember correctly, this was not just an overlay. It was
milling.
Excavating the pavement that's out there now and starting from scratch with two layers.
May I ask another question? Who was the contractor?
Who pulled into the parking lot?
It begins with an A. They're up the street.
Yeah. Action. Yeah. Okay. I'd say, you know, before we do, you know, we don't need to make any action tonight, but, you know, let's see if we can find out what the old, you know, who wrote that bit that you wrote up, and that's what it came back in to do the entire parking lot, not just the U.
Right.
Well, the U, was that done to just slap down concrete, tar, or was it to do it to the spec for the town?
I don't know.
Steve, quick question. Doesn't the board approve the RFP?
Mm-hmm. So well, it wasn't an RFP. It was a bid spec that went out.
Did the board approve the bid spec?
Yes.
So what the heck?
Well, they went out for it, and they came back, and then everyone refused to support it.
But they approved the spec? Go out the bid?
They'd have to.
Mm-hmm. No. Okay.
So, in the interest of time tonight, again, we don't have to vote on this, but this is exactly what we need to do is have these discussions, and we'll call for a vote at a little bit later time. Next one is the Prospect Hill exterior tank repair, $100,000. So, Mary Beth, that's to the coating that we found was failing on the exterior of the tank. Mm-hmm. When was the last time it was coated? Do we know? You don't have to,
it hasn't been. That's the problem. There's been no maintenance done to the tank.
Do we know when that was built?
In the 80s. Is that one, I believe, something in the 80s did it go in? 90s?
Okay.
Early 80s.
Early 80s?
And so the inspection turned up that it needs to be fixed.
But it's been showing up on the inspection. Last year I presented repairing the spalling and cracking of the concrete and treating the exterior coatings last budget year, and the board denied that. They wouldn't fund it. They wouldn't approve the funds. And I based upon that putting it in the capital for this capital because of the report we had for the previous year's inspection. So we had another inspection done this year and conditions have gotten a little worse.
So General, I'd say failure to act here, and if we have a failure of the tank, we'd be an egregious thing to let that happen. So any comments about supporting this or deferring it?
I think it's a very important issue. Is the pricing, is there some due diligence with the pricing?
Yeah, last year when I presented to the board, I got an engineer's estimate for painting. It was $80,000. But now we're looking at a year and a half, you know, 2 years out. So I increased it to $100,000.
So we had one estimate or three?
It's an engineering estimate for budgeting purposes. That's all.
I know, but we have an engineering estimate for $400,000 for a dehumidification project on the plant. Well, we already got pricing for $60,000. So if you, when you call up an engineering firm and you get pricing like that, it doesn't, it needs to be looked at more scrutinized.
Would you like me to write another RFP for tank painting specs? Because that's a lot of work.
So an did you put an RFP out for an engineering firm to come up with a price?
No, I didn't, Mr. Toby. Okay. And what's my customers is that I call up an engineering firm that I have worked with, and you ask them for a price for budgeting purposes right. only. That's it. You don't go out and ask 3, 4, 5 engineering firms, what do you think, what do you think, for a cost analysis to nickel and dime a budget item. I am confident with this number.
Based on your experience in the industry?
In the industry, I've always done that. My entire 20 years I've called an engineering firm.
My question is that seen to be a reasonable and customary estimate? Is that in the ballpark of what your past experiences are?
To be honest with you, I've never had a tank in this. I've never had to have a failed tank coatings. The system's been maintained. Okay.
Mr. Chairman, I'd like to make a motion that we approve this one.
Okay. I know we're going to do approvals tonight, but
well,
if you'd like to, certainly.
I'm not in an approval mode for that. I need I would like to see some more pricing or some other projects that they've done and see what the projects cost. There's plenty of information out there for these contractors doing some coatings on tanks for municipalities. You get a better handle on the pricing.
Yeah. Stu, can you withdraw that motion?
It hasn't been seconded.
Mm. All right.
All right.
Past it. Okay. The next thing is paving the Pingree Farm Road, 160. There'd be trees that need to be cut back. My biggest concern there, and I know a few people have very significant concerns, they don't think it should be paved. Personally, I'm not driving my car down that road. I shouldn't ever have to, but I have a couple of times for a couple of meetings, and my car bottomed out. And the biggest concern is those tankers carrying the chemicals down that road and in the winter. So, Mr. Petrillo?
Yeah, Rob Petrillo, Edwards Street. At town meeting, this thing was voted down better than 2-1. Mm-hmm. They were, a year and a half ago, it was because the road was so bad. They didn't pave it, but they graded it and put in, I think, crushed stone. And the road is in excellent condition now. If not excellent, it's very good. A little while ago, I heard that the problem was overhanging branches hitting the trucks that were coming in. These trucks that go in and out are all heavy equipment. I would think that a few branches wouldn't bother them too much. Last week, someone said, my truck got muddy on the road. Well, if it's a truck, it's supposed to get muddy because that means you might be doing your job. This road does not need to be done. There's nothing wrong with it. And if the trucks can't get in and out, I absolutely can't believe it.
Well, I know it's being, you've got a thing, you've got a paving estimate, grading estimate.
Gentlemen, I drove in there today so I could speak intelligently tonight. That road is not in bad condition at all. Miss Weiser has a grading estimate in here for $985. I would be in favor of that. That's all it needs. And most of it's pretty good. Just up near the, before you get to the asphalt weigh-in, you have a little mud, that's the only place. A few puddles on the way.
All right, that's stewing.
Nothing serious.
Okay, well, Tim, any comment?
Yeah.
As far as getting it, going in there, there are 5 gravel roads in Raleigh, and Pingree Farm Road is good as any of them.
Okay, Tim?
you know, that road was used, and it was used, and it was in pretty bad shape because they were being used by construction crews for a couple of years. And it was fixed by Warren, I think it was last fall. And it seems to be in very good order right now. What I would think would be needed would be to maybe widen it out with the trees, maybe take some of the trees out on the sides, and give it some more area to have more safety down there. So I think that's all that's really needed, is continued maintenance. Over the last, I don't know, 30 years, we've been maintaining that road and not having any problems with it. And so this now, if we spend some money and maybe clear out the branches, let's make the trees a little bit more open, I think that's all we need for that road.
Yeah.
So that 160,000, I would put that off completely.
All right. And moving on to the dehumidification process, we've had extended discussions on that. There's an RFP. Has that been out yet?
Mm-hmm.
Okay, well, that's further down the agenda, so I'm going to wait until we get the report on what's going on with that.
So is that that's going to go out, and we'll get some pricing on that to see what the...
Yeah, we'll see what's what.
Yeah.
And then the F-550 dump truck for 70 grand. Mary Beth, you and I had discussions on that. You've got an 850 or an
850.
An 850 and the 450. Too big, too small. You want one that's just right size, the expression is.
Mm-hmm. But I put 70 in there. I hadn't had a chance to, and I thought, you know, Mr. Dazelle helped us out quite a bit last budget process with the current vehicle that's on order right now. So I'm sure that's not a good number. Commissioner Dazelle, have you had a chance to take a look at any 550s in your travels over the last week or so?
65.
Ooh, wasn't bad.
She was close.
They're at they just go up out of sight. They just keep going up.
So with respect to, is that factoring in trade-in for those other trucks, or just is all ballpark estimate?
No, you'd get something for the other trucks.
Okay, so Tim, do you support that moving forward?
Okay, so the 70,000 is with the trade-in of the 850 and the 450?
No, the 70,000 is just for budget purposes. And if it went out to bid, it would be so much money, plus those trucks.
Okay.
Like the truck that's on order now.
The F-850, is that big?
Yeah, F-800.
That's the big truck we
have.
The
behemoth.
Yeah.
Okay.
So I'll work on that, these budget items with Mary Beth, and we'll come back another meeting with some more formal proposals. Okay. Cross-connection bylaw. We have a draft. It's in your packet, gentlemen.
Excuse me? What does cross-connection mean?
That means if you, and Mary Beth, you can correct me if I get it wrong, that means if you have a well,
okay,
and you have town water, well, people on the camera want to make sure the town people at home, if you have a well and you have a connection to town water, you have to make sure that you do not have backflow from the unregulated water into the potable water system. For example, I have a irrigation system that hasn't been turned on, and it has a backflow preventer because it's taking in the water, but that water sits in the system after it goes out, and there's chemicals on the lawn and everything else. You want to make sure that that water does not go back into your potable water. So the big $200 hunk of brass that has fractured twice in my 20 years here in Raleigh because it wasn't blown out correct, but my backflow preventer failed. So that now exposed the public water supply to potential
so pollutants. The water doesn't siphon.
Yeah.
The water out on the lawn doesn't siphon yeah. back.
So we have no cross-connection bylaw, and with people wanting to, there are multiple homes that have wells and also town water, and we need to have some regulations in there, and I've met with Charlie Abbott from the Board of Health, we're gonna have a joint meeting with them after the first of the year, and we'll have a public information session to let people know what this all really means, why we need it from a public health standpoint. I don't wanna pick on a horse farm, but say, some of the horse farms around, if they, oh, do you guys have horses? I'm sorry, it's just the first thing that came to mind. If you have a dog kennel, okay? Sorry, if you got a dog kennel and you're washing off the dogs and whatnot, and you have a town well, you have town water and a well, and you switch back and forth, that is a huge risk. So we need to address that and get the bylaws in place so that we can tell people, you've gotta choose. You gotta go one way or the other, and if you make the selection that you're doing your own thing, you literally are on your own.
The bottom line is, cannot have well water tied into your house with town water.
Yeah, it's, but we need the bylaws to enforce that, and so that's coming, and we'll address that the first of the year. Questions on that?
Who wrote that up?
It's pretty much boilerplate, Mary Beth.
The Mass DEP has a boilerplate ordinance that all communities can use, but we added a section in ours to include, because it is unique, residential wells.
Yeah, so she tailored it to the town.
Mm-hmm.
Okay, moving on. Tim, research of old water board policies update. We said by the end of November, if you had some, you were gonna bring them in.
Yeah, I don't have them.
Okay, should we leave this on or remove it or?
Do what you want.
I will remove it. Okay, update on the sale of the old plow.
We haven't had a chance to get it on Craigslist.
Okay.
Actually, hindsight is 2020. That should have went with the truck that was being traded in. Because I believe the plow frame went with the old truck, am I correct?
Yes, and thank you for joining my memory. So I was talking with the guys, and it did go with the truck. And if you have a chance, if you can look up on top of that, the board last week said they wouldn't entertain any offers under $1,500.
That is correct.
I think you need to take a look at that again. If you could, you're the expert, Mr. Dalzell, if you could look at that plow. It's so rusted and holes, and it's basically useless, right, without the controls? Because isn't somebody going to ask me if it works, the controls, and I can't answer?
When I deliver the new truck, the easiest way to give them the plow, because it was part of the old truck that they've taken the old truck already, right?
Yes.
Be nice if they picked up the plow to go with it.
I will ask them, but they already sent the flatbed over once.
Well, yeah, what Mary Beth is saying is, I have not looked at it, but taking the word, it's pretty well rusted.
Yeah.
Of course, they're open salt all the time.
Yeah. And there's like holes. The whole thing has holes.
If it's perforated, yeah. Do we want to change our vote to say, see if the...
Can we just go to scrap it?
Well, scrap it, say if the dealer wants to take it with the... to go with a truck. I had second thoughts about this Craigslist after I left here last week. I don't know if that's legal or not without going through the process.
Yeah, well, you can come back and tell us, you're telling us, so make a new motion to do it.
I'd like to withdraw our motion from last week.
Okay.
And to see if the dealer would like the plow to go with that truck.
Or scrap it if they don't want it?
That's correct.
Okay. Do you want to second that, Tim?
Scrap it. I'll second that.
All in favor?
Aye.
Aye. Opposed? Passes?
Thank you.
Good. It cleans that up. And update on new proposed fees. And you gentlemen have that in your packet. And last week we asked, excuse me, we asked Mary Beth to put a list together from our comparison to Topsfield, Salisbury, and Georgetown, nearby residences. Do we have that? Do you want to walk through these?
Sure. So I didn't have much time, but I did manage to get some communities. I haven't really put the information in a spreadsheet format, but I know that when I rolled out these fees, there was a little bit of concern about, you know, who's gonna pay for these and how are you going to do this? So I thought I would just share with you Newburyport's costs for the same job, for the same size services that we had. So for in Newburyport, the connection fee for a 1-inch service is $1,400, and I was recommending $1,500. The 2-inch service is $4,270, and I was recommending $1,850. 4-inch service is $7,140. I didn't, 4-inch service, I was recommending $2,000. The 6-inch service was $10,000, and I was recommending $2,200, and it goes up $13,000, $16,000, $20,000. That's Newburyport. Now, I don't know what their fees cover, if that's the tapping, if that's just, it says connection fee. So I don't know if the connection fee, no, it looks like they charge, nope, they charge for the tap. So that's the connection fee for a new service and new water main connections, and then they charge to tap the water main in on top of that. So that was just Newburyport. I thought that was interesting. So those, okay. I will tell you, I've never seen fees that high.
Well, it's, this is filmed, I was gonna say, it is Newburyport. but hopefully they don't watch this. So Mary Beth, if you can, continue your research,
yeah.
And don't put this on the agenda until you get the material together and then okay. Just present it to us.
Okay.
You guys okay with that? Okay.
Nice job. Just one. So these fees are your fees, recommended fees. And then with comparing it to Newburyport, they had like a 2-inch tapping fee. Is what would you say was $1,400?
$4,270.
Mm-hmm. And so is that, and then they have also a connection fee?
That is their connection fee.
That's their connection fee?
Mm-hmm.
So we have a connection fee. Isn't it like $3,000 or something like that?
You have an application fee, which is $4,000.
$4,000. Plus, they'd be paying this too. So it'd be like, for a 2-inch service, it'd be $5,850?
Yes.
Okay.
I'd like to see when price, gentlemen, like on a 1-inch service, X number of dollars, but that includes the tap and two of the curb stop, and the customer's on their own. Mm-hmm. Instead of $4,000 for the application, so much for the tap and all the
one. More of a bundled price?
Exactly.
Can we do that? Or do we
well,
have
we
that?
Have that now, don't we? But we don't have tapping fees. We just have a hookup fee.
No, you have a tap. You have
tapping fee.
You do have a tapping fee. You should list them separate. You should list them separate because when you're preparing the documentation, we actually have a checklist. So when the customer comes in and they pay the application fee, we write the date down. Then when they get closer in the project and they're going to do the tap, they may come in and pay for the tap at a later date. So we do keep track of the whole application process. We haven't, the water department hasn't, for obvious reasons, done any tapping in the water main. There's nobody. So the contractor has been hiring somebody else to tap the water main. We've just been going out there to witness, to make sure it's done correctly.
Mm-hmm.
That's it.
Okay. So again, I'd say to the finish, that's a lot of research. So just continue on that. And then when you have it, you know, bring it back, let's get it on the agenda and do it when you're ready. But thanks for that first pass, that's interesting. Any other questions, gentlemen? Steve? Okay. Moving on to new business, abatement 250 Dodge Road, Tim Lesquad. Lesquadi.
Somebody is that an appointment?
Someone did earlier, they canceled it for another issue. So I'll read this into the record. The request says, I feel there must have been some error. If you look at the history on the account, you can clearly see something is out of the ordinary. Can I please make some sort of compromise of this latest bill, thank you. And they're looking for $118 adjustment. And from a leak standpoint, was there anything in the things that would say there was a leak, Mary Beth?
This is all we got. They're just disputing the high bill. They're not indicating that there's no indication that there was a leak. And they didn't, they haven't attached any documentation of repair of a leak.
And looking at the thing here, it's gone up since 2013, just kind of a trend line basis, you know, pretty fairly consistent up. And then from the warm weather months here, it's gone from August, from May onward, 34, 36, 37, 39, 41. It looks very consistent with increased, just a consistent increased usage versus anything that's spiky with a leak or a failure. So I'm not inclined to support that abatement.
Once you have an abatement on, you know, the agenda and you're denied, can you come back? Do people come back?
You have to look at the policy.
They're like in a, I don't know, like say he realized it was a problem.
With new evidence, I'd entertain that, sure. Someone, why not?
I'm just wondering.
Someone found something and had some
right.
evidence.
And, mm-hmm.
Yeah, I mean, they're our neighbors. I'm not going to say we're not talking to you. Yeah, no, I'd definitely entertain it. Bring the new evidence. You know.
Is there, Danny Cullen, Weathersfield Street, is there a way in which any homeowner can actually check whether there's leaks? And if I went away for 2 weeks, I would expect to see no water usage while I'm away, right? Is there another procedure that the water department has to kind of verify the fact that there's no leakage?
Kick your meter.
Yeah.
Well, we can't. It's all radio now, right? It's not visible. I can't check.
You put a flashlight on.
You're saying if he's away, if you're away on vacation or you go to Florida,
We read
the meters once a month. Mm-hmm. If your meters are equipped with the leak detector, so when we tally up all of the information we collect, if an account that historically had low usage shows high usage, the customer is sent a leak letter. And that tells them you may have a leak, and mm-hmm. the first thing we suggest is people come in and get the dye tabs and check the toilet.
Yeah.
But we don't, other than reading the water meters, which are on radio, we don't physically go inside homes or look in the meter pits. We just drive through and get them. No.
So to your answer, you'd have to wait for the monthly billing and see if there was an anomaly, and then have to proceed from there.
So there's no way of having a radio. The homeowner can't read the meter. Let me just check to make sure my other. I thought they took the dials away and now it was just a radio.
Yeah,
the dials are still on there.
No, you can still you have to shine a flashlight. When you look at the water meter, it looks like it's doing nothing because the little LCD screen is black or
right.
blank. You shine a flashlight down on it, you're going to see the activity that's going on. And if you see a dripping faucet on your water meter, you have a leak. And you don't always have to hear running water to have a leak. Your toilet can be leaking, and you wouldn't even know it if you don't hear it, because that rubber flapper, all it takes is one little piece of grain of sand, and water could be slipping by, and you know you don't hear it. But that tank is always filling up because it's always draining. So.
The summer months, even back in 13, to answer my usage here. Mm-hmm. With that being said, I have to vote against it.
Okay. So you want to make a motion to deny?
I'll make a motion that we deny the request.
A second?
I'll second that.
In favor?
Yeah, no, it's probably not that much money.
I'm opposed. Okay.
Mr. Chairman? Right here. What is that
You said something about a leak detector, or is it on everybody's?
Mary Beth referenced that in the new installations have a leak detector built in.
Oh, I was just wondering, I never knew it, I never heard of it before.
Yep. So with all the expense of the technology, at least we're getting some benefit out of that too.
Sure, sure.
New business number two, one-time courtesy adjustment. That's a policy, and I will read this into the record. One-time courtesy adjustment policy. The purpose of this policy is to allow for a one-time courtesy adjustment for a lost discount or to waive interest due to a delayed payment based on the following. The customer must be in good standing with the department. This is defined as a customer who has not had a past due balance during the previous 12 months. There was an emergency or other circumstance that delayed the customer payment. There was a delay in the normal delivery time through the postal service. Customers should allow for at least 1 week delivery window when mailing payment. Amount of adjustment fee is less than $10 and specific to a lost discount or interest applied for payment that is less than 3 days from the due date. This is a one-time courtesy adjustment. It will not be offered more than one time. And this is as of November 24th for a version. And discussion or vote to accept?
I have no problem with that.
Want to mention motion to accept?
One time per year, one time per lifetime.
I think it's, wasn't that it was 3 years or is it just period?
Well, this is up for discussion, so if you know, one time a year, once every 5 years, just like the abatement.
Yeah, I think we should amend it to say once every 3 years. Seems to be a number that I've seen frequently. Stu, what do you think about that?
Adding I'll follow on that.
Okay. Once every 3 years? Tim?
Okay.
Okay, as amended. So, Stu, you've made a motion to accept as amended with every 3 years. Tim, you want to second?
I'll second that.
Okay, all in favor?
Aye.
Opposed? Passes.
Thank you.
Yeah. Thank you for asking whoever that was. Yeah. Letter from Bernie Cullen dated September 30th, 2015. Mr. Cullen had a whole bunch of items that he'd like us to talk about or address and such. And I'll read his letter into the record. He's with us tonight. So. To the Board of Water Commissioners, present folks here, and Mary Beth Weiser, the superintendent. I would like the Board of Water Commissioners to consider the following items for your next available agenda. Statement of funds available to the Water Department, including surpluses from prior years. Review and amendment, if necessary, of the 15-16 budget and early formulation provisional 16-17 budget. Reassessment of water rates, including current step feature and absence of minimum fee in the light of revised budget outlook. Increasing the sign-off level for the water and superintendent to a level that would significantly reduce the delays in payment and involvement of the commissioners in ongoing improved spending items. The setting up of a planning group to explore ways to significantly reduce the water costs for the town, including the possible outsourcing or insourcing of operations and or the provision of the water to neighboring communities and the possible shifting of capital costs of the water treatment plant to the general budget of the town. Plan for expansion of a number of seats in the Board of Water Commissions to 5 to allow for more discussions among water commissioners. Establishment of regular office hours at the Water Department that reflect the needs of the town, i.e. Saturday morning. Installation of floodlights at the Central Street Water Department office to improve safety in the parking lot. Removal of derelict equipment, vehicles at the office and cleanup of the immediate area. Please feel free to contact me if any of the items need clarification. You decide not to include any of the above items on the upcoming agenda. So Mary Beth responded to Bernie with multiple items, and as people were listening to this, I think you can know that some of the items have been addressed, the derelict equipment, the funding, we're working on the budget already. Getting the water board expanded, that requires a state items. We've had the parking lot lit, etc. I can go right down this, but there's something a little further on the agenda that I'd like to wait for more discussion on this, Bernie. I think, what am I calling it? The outstanding issues for the water board. It's 4 pages of items. Someone commented that in the past that we've, you know, how do you keep track of things as things are going on and off the agenda? Well, I want to read this into the record and let people see it tonight, that there is a quite a laundry list of items. There's a lot of things that need to be addressed. And I want people to know that the stuff just doesn't fall into an abyss. I can't speak for the past, but now that's the way I roll, and want to do that with Mary Beth so that we can keep everybody informed, appraised, and know where the money's going and some of the challenges facing the department, and to it, the town, really. So, Bernie, I'll give you some time to fill in. Comments?
My only comment was, and this is not ideally worded, I did not expect everything to be addressed on a particular agenda. I expected it to be all spread out as as time and other agenda items allowed. I guess the big issue for me is the bigger picture and the fact that we've, as I've said now 3 or 4 times, we have the most expensive water in Massachusetts, and we should be trying to figure out how to not have the most expensive water in Massachusetts.
Mm-hmm. And the reason I put this in, Bernie, is I asked Mary Beth to put it on, is I want people to understand that that this board serves the ratepayers and everyone, and everyone has a say, and it's not a matter of we like this, we don't like this, and we're not going to do things. We'll address it, and as you said, thank you, Bernie, for taking a long-term perspective. There's an awful lot of work to be done, but we're up to the challenge, and we'll get there. So. And yes, the rates are high. I think you'll find other communities in the Commonwealth will be moving in that direction as they bring new plants online, as the DEP tightens rules and regulations. So pretty much ahead of the curve, if you will. It's just, you know, miserable to be there at this point. So, any comment, gentlemen?
Nobody would like to see the rates come down any more than I would.
Yeah, I'd love to turn my irrigation system.
We're here, as you said, we're here for the ratepayers.
Yep. And item 4, it was addressed a couple of meetings back. It was the legislature's authorization to let the Board of Water Commissioners award abatements and how that works. So I'm not going to address that tonight. Talked to Larry White offline. He understands that. General business, Water Superintendent Operations Report. First thing I need to do is catch up with my own notes here. this is a note from the Board of Assessors, Sean McFadden. On behalf of the Board of Assessors, I'd like to thank you for your assistance during the fiscal year 2016 tax rate setting process. For the first time in many years, the Water Department did not hold up the property tax approval process. In fact, we received not one question regarding your department's submissions. The detailed letter you provided, which explained the budget and the rate changes, clearly addressed any concerns the DOR and the Department of Revenue has questioned in the past. Thank you for your assistance. Additionally, with the Water Superintendent Report, yesterday was the last day of the month, and it's being developed. And we put this on because I wanted it there, but it's not ready. I guess the best way it's, you know, it didn't work around the clock.
We tried.
Okay. And anyways, then this speaks to we about 3 meetings ago, possibly and longer, voted to set the rate or the lien time to be September 30th, I think it was, and that gave the assessors some leeway to get their work done timely. And I will talk about liens, I think, a little further down. That's the next one. So, questions? Okay. Next item. Oh, wait a minute.
Is the operation report a public document?
Yeah, it's produced, it's available right here. When Mary Beth produces it, it's part of the minutes. So probably for the next meeting, we'll have that. Next meeting?
Yes.
Yeah. Okay. And we've asked for some changes to it from the way we report the data. What's produced, what's sold.
Yes, I'm working on changing that last section.
Yeah.
And then coming up, we're, this will be the last month we'll be reporting on in 2015. So once January hits, you'll start to see us comparing 2016 data to 2015. So you'll start to see, the board will be able to take, like right now, the one that was easiest to do was the system delivery. Mm-hmm. So you're able to see what we produced last year as compared to this year, and whether we produce more or less in the same time period. So we'll start to do the same thing with the other, with the other categories too.
Yep. Mr. Chairman, I just had an email, and I have an emergency, so I'm gonna have to excuse myself.
Okay, I hope everything's okay. So, moving along to item number two, water lien update.
We started out with 156 letters that went out for people who had outstanding balance as of September 30, 2015. And last week we had 90, and as of today, around 4 o'clock, we had 42 liens, and a total about $14,000. That's just, we'll have the finalized list on Friday, so that could change. But I asked Tara from Penachuk if she could provide me with some kind of update for the board. So we're at 42, so that's, we got, you know, a little over half, you know, half.
It's a third left.
Yep. So we'll be, Friday I'll have a finalized list, and that's the list that will go to the assessor so that he can do his thing.
Okay. And how's that, I know we discussed this last week, I don't have my note in front of me. From last year it was like 30 grand, now it's 14 grand, roughly.
Oh, that's what's remaining. The 42 liens equates to 14,000.
Right.
Yes.
And last year I think
it was around 37,000, 38,000.
Okay, that's good.
But the criteria was different. We set a criteria, the board set a criteria of over $500. So that left out all that, you know, $2 to $4.99, which we did not
clean up stuff.
Yet. Yes. Okay.
And I haven't looked at this, but and you may not have either, but are these significant liens, or like $100, or is it some, you know, accounting errors, you know, $350, $4, that kind of stuff?
They're from,
they're all over the place.
$5 up to, I think, $4,000 maybe was the highest one. But we did receive quite, I actually scanned, I've had a feeling you might ask today when they came in. I don't usually look, but I scanned the total dollar amount. And so we got a $500 today, $800 checks, $1,000 checks. So we did get some revenue in today.
Great. All right. Now, I'll actually, items 3 and 4 on the agenda, list of things to do, ongoing agenda items, list of outstanding issues from the water board. I'll hold this up first. I've been working on this with Mary Beth. That's this, and this, and this. Okay? So, I don't know, do people have an appetite to listen to all of these items, or they can get them in the, they'll be attached to the minutes. Okay? But that's, to Brent, those are all on there for that. But. This is everything. I mean, some of them have been done. Hydrant flushing, okay. And the reason I asked Mary Beth to do this is that people have said, and someone I think that might be here asked a comment, how do you make sure that you don't drop things or things have disappeared and come back on the agendas? This will be the control document. And so we'll keep this, we'll add to it, but we'll also take things off as we get them completed. So that next year, this time, we can look and say, we had 4 pages of issues, okay? We now have 2 pages of issues. Maybe they're more significant, less significant. Doesn't matter. They're things that need to be addressed. They need the board's attention. And I'd say this summer, I just joined the board in May, I think there's been a lot of distractions, warranted, unwarranted, just distractions from getting things where they need to be. And I think we're going to try and move forward and try and communicate what's going on, what we're working on. You know, we'll keep this, we'll bring this up every now and then, periodically, to just let people know how we're doing. Kind of a self-check, if you will, and saying, you know, hold us accountable. It gives the public a tool to, again, hold us accountable as well. I know other boards have done things like this, but it's kind of a new way to do it, but I've used it successfully other places, and I think it will kind of help us get where we need to be and want to bring the department. So, Mary Beth, anything you want to add? Or? I'm just going to give the superintendent and Stu a chance first. So, Mary Beth?
No.
Okay. Stu, any comments? Or?
No comment.
Okay.
Mr. Chairman, will this information be available on the internet, like the Water Department website, or do you have to go to an office to see?
Can we attach this as minutes to the, as a one time?
This will be attached to the minutes, but this is like, you know, everyone
just
has a to-do list.
Yeah. It's a push list.
This is so I don't forget. I have this on my desktop, and I go in it, and I take things off, and I add things all the time. So, no, this isn't going to be on the webpage, because it's, you know, on here is simple things as, you know, the draft SOPs up to, so I don't forget to schedule the 2016 flushing in the spring.
Okay.
So it's all the programs and things that we do so that, you know, certain things are time of the year, and I use this with my calendar so I don't forget.
Okay.
So from flushing and lean updates to some here, Prospect Hill fencing, Prospect Hill coating, booster chlorination, asset management, staffing updates.
Yeah.
So it's pretty much her punch list. Someone used that's a perfect idea. But it's her to-do list, punch list. And so if you know, someone thinks something's not happening, we'll have this list out there. And if we refresh it, we'll repost the refresh list. But when these gets posted with the minutes, I'd encourage everyone to go take a look. And if you think something's missing, you know, give citizens query or just drop us an email, either way. And we'll get it in here, and that's how we'll, if it doesn't get brought up in citizens query, that's how we, you know, we can get it into the list to monitor and track. So hopefully this will resonate with people and help them understand the body of work that's in front of the Water Department. Some of it's day-to-day, some of it's strategic, some of it is maintenance that has to be, you know, have-tos versus want-tos, is the way I put it. Suggestion for future board topics, future meeting? Stu, do you have anything off the top?
No, I don't, right.
Okay.
Off the top of my head.
All right. We do have a proposed agenda for. Did we do that yet?
No.
No, we didn't. Okay, because.
We didn't do next week, no.
Yeah, I have an issue with the next water board meeting. It was supposed to be the 15th. I have a personal conflict, and I'd like to push it out to the next week, to the 22nd. If possible?
Well, next week instead.
The 8th?
Yes.
Let me double check that. I didn't look at bringing it in. I can do the 8th. but it doesn't give us much time to have things done from the last meeting. We can certainly do that. But the problem is, too, if we get rid of the 15th and do it the 8th, then we have 1, 2, 3, 4 weeks before we have another meeting, a month.
January 5th?
Yeah, January 5th. So that's what I said.
The 8th, and you can't do the 15th.
Yeah, I've got a personal conflict.
The 22nd.
Yeah, that's what I was saying. Can we do the 22nd? So that gives us 2 weeks in between and that.
Do the 8th and the 22nd.
The 8th and the 22nd?
Well, give us two.
So just
that would be 3 weeks if you push it out to 22nd.
Well, this is tonight. So
yeah,
we
the
wait
first.
2 weeks and then we have the 22nd. If we do the 22nd,
that'll
then
be
we
three
have,
weeks. One,
be
two,
weeks.
Three.
2 weeks. Well,
today's the first.
Yeah, 1 week, 2 weeks. I see what you're saying. Yeah, maybe 3 weeks. And then that would give us to about a week and a half before the 5th.
Whatever.
Okay.
So you want to do the 8th and then the 22nd?
I'd rather just skip the 8th and go to the 22nd. I just don't think we'll get too much done. We can have a meeting the 8th. There's just not going to be a big agenda. And it's mostly going to be all these minutes that we're not going to do. tonight.
Suggestion? Can we make it another evening?
Tim's got some other commitments that keeps him.
Okay, I just.
Yeah, no, we discussed that earlier.
Have a quick meeting on the 8th, just so things don't go 3 weeks.
Okay, and then if we decide to forego, well, the 15th I'm going to cancel, period.
Right.
So that people planning don't show up here. So we'll have a meeting the 8th, Mary Beth, and then we'll decide whether we do the 22nd or wait till the 5th. How's that?
Fine.
Okay. So do you want to make that motion?
I'll make a motion that we have a meeting on the 8th.
And make a decision, cancel the 15th.
And cancel the 15th, and we'll make a decision on the 22nd. Mm-hmm. How's that sound?
Yep, at the 8th.
Right.
So I'll second that. All in favor?
Aye.
Opposed? Okay. Do you want to discuss the minutes without Tim here, or do you want to wait?
You still open for suggestions for agenda?
Well, we've already voted, but.
On November 10th, I have to abstain. I was not here.
November 10th. Okay. And all of these, you know, the 24th was last week. So I don't know if you want to review these and accept them, or if you want to table them. Bernie, you got a question?
Well, I was just going to suggest an agenda item, not for the 8th, as you want to keep that meeting short, but I would like to see a census of the town in terms of the number of subscribers, the number of non-subscribers, but people who have wells, so that we have essentially it's a market survey, so you know where we are and how many people have walked away and how many potentially can be recaptured or how big an issue that is.
We'll add that to the list. We've had that discussion with the Board of Health, and that's one of the things we're going to be talking about at the first of the year with them about the cross connections.
The Board of Health is in charge of private wells.
Yeah.
So they're the ones who have the list. So they know we have nothing to do with the private wells. The only time we do is when we come across a customer that has the option of going back and forth town water.
Mm-hmm. So that's where, I mean, they have those records, but we need to work together with them to get a bylaw in place for us to get those controls. But they'll have that information that you're
right,
looking
so
for.
I understand the Board of Health's agenda. I guess my agenda would be how many people are sitting there waiting to essentially pull out of the rally water?
Our largest water customer is pulling out.
So it's that kind of issue.
We would have no way of knowing. A customer.
Well, you know the potential. You know how many people are out of both town and well water.
We'll look at it when we can get our hands on some data, but we don't have the data, and you know it's kind of a future item. But again, even the largest ratepayer, with if you look at them as a percentage of the total, if we change the way we do some billing, it would eradicate that shortage. If we go back to some policies with regards to a 10-day versus a 30-day discount, things like that.
So who's the largest ratepayer?
I don't know if we want to talk.
Disclose
the largest ratepayer?
I hate to say it.
Okay.
Yeah. So
I'll deceive you.
I can either confirm or deny, and I don't have that as fact and figures in front of me.
I don't think that's a secret.
Anyways, so Stu, have you had a chance to go through the minutes from the 24th?
I'd like to make a motion that we approve the minutes from November 24th.
I'll second. All in favor?
Aye.
Opposed? Passes. Thank you. The executive session minutes, Tim's not here and still hasn't provided them. August 25th, actually all these minutes, the 25th, 29th, October 6th has been delayed three times already, same for October 20th. Those are all missing artifacts from Mr. Toomey, and they're on the list.
Actually, the August 25th minutes, you can approve both water commissioners. This is just the open, this was an open session, so this is, there's no missing documentation, so you can vote on this if you'd like.
Okay. August 25th, the open session. Citizens Quorum. Do you have this, Steve?
I've read these about four times over the last few months. Yeah. I'll make a motion that we approve the minutes.
I'll second.
From August 25th.
I'll second. All in favor?
Aye.
Opposed? Passes.
Thank you.
You can also approve the October 20th, and then Commissioner Dazza.
So we got the documentation?
The 10th, he's going to abstain, but the 20th you can approve this. Those are fine.
So we have all those items, okay, good. And I will note that one of the questions there is if the minutes could be sent out previous to the meetings. They have things settling down, Mary Beth has got her people producing the minutes, and last weekend and this week we had the minutes prior to the meeting, so we're actually able to review them. So that reduced a lot of time.
Okay, this October 6th, the comment I had on that last week was Steve McConley's name was spelled wrong. It's down here is Conley. It's Conley.
Okay, October 20th.
Oh, yes, I sent those to Lisa for the revisions. The one you might have.
The old one?
Yeah, we okay. Haven't got that one back yet.
All right.
So we're waiting on the.
But the October 20th is the ones you can.
There's no quorum. There's only one. Streets. That's the staff. On this
one. Yeah, he wasn't here on the 10th.
I'm all right with October 20th.
Yeah, we have those. All in favor?
Aye.
Opposed? Nay. Passes.
Mr. Chairman, I make a motion that we adjourn.
I'll second that. And all in favor?
Aye.
Approved. Thank you all.